What's going on, everybody? I'm Jory Goodman, the Time Teller. So we already covered the history of Wittenauer, we already covered the history of Waltham, and overwhelmingly, one watchmaker stands out in the comment section of those episodes, Elgin. Okay, Elgin is such a special company because, especially with us American watch collectors, I feel like we have a lot of connections with Elgin, especially when it comes to some of our older family members, okay? I feel like a lot of us have been passed down Elgin watches, whether it be from our parents or our grandparents. Just judging by the comment section, there's a lot of sentimental value with this company. I know for myself included, I have my great grandfather's Elgin Small Seconds from 1930, and that's easily like one of my most valuable watches. I will never ever get rid of it. It's priceless. It is priceless because, again, of that family connection, that sentimental value. So Elgin is a very, very interesting company. It's one of a handful of companies that have a rich history in true American horology. And that is absolutely not something we see nowadays. So let's talk about it. What happened to Elgin? It's 2:37 p.m. Let's get down to business. Alright guys, so let's jump way back to 1864 when six Chicagoans came together to start the National Watch Company. Now guys, this is the funniest part of their history, okay? Back in 1864, watchmaking was not a super prominent job, like there weren't a whole lot of watchmakers, and it definitely wasn't what it was like in the 1800s in Switzerland, where you can literally go to any bakery and you could be like, excuse me, do you have someone that knows how to make a timepiece? And they'd be like, yeah, this is me, I do the watches. In America, it was not like that, but it is still like that in Switzerland. What I'm trying to say is that watchmaking was not super common in the United States. It's still not very common in the US, especially when we're comparing ourselves to Europe. So literally the six founders of the National Watch Co. flew to Waltham, Massachusetts and poached seven of Waltham's top watchmakers and coerced them to come work for Elgin. Now they weren't known as Elgin just yet because again, around this time, they were officially the National Watch Company. So the six founders of National Watch Co. along with their seven Waltham watchmakers came together and decided what to do next. Now, although the founders, again, were officially from Chicago, Illinois, a few miles down the road, they realized it would be more cost-effective to start their first plant in Elgin. So in 1874, officially producing watches in Elgin, Illinois, they were officially known as Elgin National Watch Company. So reading this part of Elgin's history is also kind of sentimental to me because, again, not only do I own my great-grandfather's Elgin watch, my dad, who grew up in Chicago, born and raised, he actually helped demolish the defunct Elgin factory. So yeah, just some really interesting family history with this company, and it's very special to me. Now, perhaps one of my favorite parts about Elgin National Watch Company is they have one of the most metal logos ever. It's Father Time holding a scythe with wings and a clock. So, total badass. But badass logo aside, let's go ahead and take a look at some Elgin watches. You might know them as Elgin, Lord Elgin, or Lady Elgin. And you might think, okay, these are just kind of basic, simple, old school vintage watches, nothing really special, right? Well, you're somewhat right. They are old school, elegant, kind of understated, but simple, they are not. You see, in 1910, Elgin built the Elgin National Watch Company Observatory, and taken from the observatory's Wikipedia page, the two-story observatory provided data on time that was scientifically accurate to a tenth of a second. So this is not just some just rinky-dink operation. They were really investing a lot into making their watches as accurate as possible. Another thing I really love about Elgin watches is they're very quaint and elegant and sometimes a little bit art deco, but nothing really out of place. They give me old school Hamilton vibes, and that's a really good thing. That's a huge compliment. But one of my favorite eras when we're looking at these old school, somewhat defunct companies is the 1960s to 1970s sports watch era. So first up, I want to take a look at this old school 1970s Waltham. This has a bunch of really cool colors, a little bit loud with the splashes of orange, large oversized cushion case, and I think, yeah, one crown on this one, but when we move move over to Wittenauer, they didn't want to be left out. They have their own version of kind of an oversized sports watch. Not really oversized, but it does have a super compressor aesthetic, two crowns. And then Hamilton, not to be left out, has their own super compressor. This is one of their famous Aqua Dates. And this is a very sought after watch, very expensive when you find them at auction or secondhand. This is a super compressor, dual crown. And I know, Hamilton's not defunct. People are gonna be like, what the heck? But I just wanna kind of cover this really cool era when they were trying something new, kind of moving away from smaller watches and making larger, sportier watches. I wanna take a look at this Lord Elgin, because again, we're talking about Elgin. And this is, I guess, not technically a super compressor because the crowns are recessed into that oversized case, but there are two crowns in there. And again, large sports watch, diver, date complication, 1960s, 1970s, golden era, in my opinion, for these companies. I love it. But unfortunately, that era, the 1960s, for Elgin anyway, was kind of their last big push when it came to producing anything as we know them. You see, by 1968, Elgin ended all US production for any of their products. And then after that, the name Elgin kind of floundered around for a while, and then it was picked up by MZ Berger Incorporated. And as you can imagine, they just purchased the Elgin name and slapped it on a Chinese produced product, and that's the Elgin of today. But as it is stated all over the internet from various sources, anything produced after 1968 that has the Elgin branding is not Elgin National Watch Company. Has nothing to do with that. Totally different Elgin. And just to finish up this episode, because I know I'm going to get a ton of comments, it should be stated, Elgin made a lot of pocket watches. Now, this is not a pocket watch channel. I don't really have much experience with pocket watches, so you gotta you just gotta bear with me until I learn a little bit more. But yeah, I know a lot of my viewers are also really into pocket watches, but this is a wristwatch channel. Okay, I'm gonna stick with what I know. Pocket watches are for nerds. But guys, let me know what you think. This was a really fun episode. I really enjoy kind of delving into some research and learning a little bit more about these companies. So what's the next company? Some of you are saying Gruen, some of you are saying Lamagna. Which one will it be? Leave me a comment. Which history should we explore next? Leave me that comment. I'd love to hear from you. Guys, check out all the affiliate links in the description below. Check out my channel memberships. That's right. Become a certified T3 bot. $4.99 a month. Hit that join button next to the subscribe button. You get 6 pieces of content a week and access to the members only Discord chat. Whole lot of fun. I'd love to see you there. Check out my personal website, www.thetimetellershop.com, where we have had Wittenauers, Walthams, Hamiltons, and Elgins, even a Lord Elgin. Like, comment, and subscribe. Share this with everyone you know. I'm sure they'd be interested in some very rich horological history. I'm Jory Goodman, the Time Teller. Always remember, I didn't invent time. I just tell it. I'm sweating.